Hi, everyone, and welcome to another week in MHA621, where the content topic is really an excellent one, access to healthcare. And so let's dive into the material. This is going to be really a focus post-ACA, so post-Obamacare, looking at some of the implications, some of the output, and really what it means. So we'll keep going. At the end of this module, hopefully you're going to be able to compare and contrast with a little bit of focus on really the focus of the access to healthcare, both from a user and provider's perspective, and provider, healthcare professional, healthcare organization. So this is from a fairly recent from the most recent Census Bureau results, looking at the percentage of people by type of health insurance in the United States. You can see the change is from year to year. In this case, it's from 2020 to 2021. Affordable Care Act passed in 2010, but it was really years later, mainly in 2014 and afterwards, that its true implications really were felt. In 2021, about 92% of the population had health insurance, leaving about 8% of the population uninsured. Now, pre-ACA, if you look at the numbers, it really hovered around an uninsured rate of 15% of the population, 12 to 15. So, I mean, the goal of the ACA was to provide access, and it certainly did. Now, it mainly did it by boosting up the Medicaid rates. We'll talk Medicaid coverage, but we'll talk about that. But this is the breakdown, as you can see, between private insurance, private plans, and public plans. And so we have these two distinct areas over here. By far, most individuals in the United States are covered under private insurance, whether that be through employer-based coverage, which is the greatest, the bulk of individuals, direct purchase. You can see the marketplace over here, which really was one of the ideas behind the Affordable Care Act, has this, you know, certainly a substantial number, but it's really the public plan, as I said, Medicaid, that really boosted those numbers. You can see the change over here as well on this side. So there's no doubt that the goal of the ACA, which was to provide more access, was able to accomplish that goal. Now let's dive into a little bit deeper just in terms of numbers. So these are, these next few slides come from the Commonwealth Fund, and very accessible documents. Every couple years, every 2 years, the Commonwealth Fund does a biannual health insurance survey. Nationwide, they've been doing this for years. Very accessible. So I picked a few slides from the most recent biannual health insurance survey to discuss. And the focus of this is on inadequate insurance coverage. Access to insurance, health insurance, which is really the goal, the primary goal of the Affordable Care Act, doesn't necessarily mean access to adequate insurance coverage. It could be inadequate. Now, there's a choice that individuals have, but that choice is limited based on a variety of factors. But let's look at this slide over here. So what we can see is this looks at specifically individuals who have insurance coverage, but it's inadequate, and they have problems paying medical bills. This is for adults of working age, 19 to 64, who had a medical bill debt problem in the past year. You can see the numbers based on the categories, from insured all year, not insured, not underinsured, underinsured, and then uninsured any time in the year. So what you'll see, as you should expect, is really a rising type of pattern for all of these, quite honestly, fairly common issues. Now, these issues certainly are born with individuals of lower income and mid-level incomes. But it's also really, sometimes it actually doesn't even matter. It's, you know, sometimes it's a catastrophic type issue where the cost skyrockets. In the past, certainly few years, a lot of, there's been a big focus in the media, big focus in individual state legislatures on, of course, I'm blanking on the topic, but it is blanking on the theme. Let's just say astronomically high healthcare bills. And I think it's surprise bills, or where an individual, it doesn't matter if they're insured or inadequately insured, are really surprised. And so state legislatures have been really passing, which arguably is in response to a variety of complaints, legislation on surprise billing, all geared towards a check and balance system being implemented with insurance companies. Let me go to the second slide here, which really focuses on, again, uninsured and underinsured individuals, adults, who avoid, delay getting needed healthcare and medication. We saw a lot of this as the COVID pandemic started, was sort of at its prime, and has sort of, you know, traversed through that individuals, not just, it wasn't just a COVID issue. It was really based on insurance, but it really was exacerbated because of the pandemic. And so again, similar categories, but didn't fill a subscription, skipped a test, didn't visit a primary care physician or a specialist, or had, you know, a number of problems accessing healthcare because of cost. Again, the trajectory is up like this. So the impact of this is profound. I share this because it is, you know, certainly we're now, you know, a number of years, a decade plus, past the ACA. I think there's a lot of positives that have come out of it, and yet there's choices that still need to be made. This slide hasn't really changed in a number of years. This is the primary reason why we have more insured individuals through the ACA than less, and it's Medicaid expansion. Certainly the healthcare marketplace has had an influence, but nothing like Medicaid expansion. So as of this, and it's unlikely that, at least in my estimate, my humble estimate, that we're going to see very many more states that go beyond what we have right now. This hasn't changed in a number of years. What you can generally see is a corridor of states in the southeast part of the United States that have not expanded Medicaid, pockets in the Midwest, and certainly Texas. What we have is a very large state over here that has not expanded Medicaid. Now, a variety of other states have expanded it in different ways, where USI is located in Indiana. I think personally, one of the most creative expansions of Medicaid, expansion of Medicaid, just in terms of its variety of products as well. And different mechanisms have been tried, perhaps failed, whether it be in Indiana, Arkansas, in terms of encouraging, almost mandating, if I can use that word, individuals to find employment as well. But anywhere between 33 and 35 million individuals have received health insurance, whether it be adequate or not, you know, the judge is still out, by being able to expand Medicaid. Now, it's certainly for a portion of the population, certainly for children, kids, it is has a profound effect. And yet, again, Medicaid, which is a state-based program, also partially funded by the federal government, is one of the two usually largest expenses in the state coffers, behind K through 12 education. So this expansion is costly, and yet it certainly does have the ability to at least help manage the health of individuals. This more than likely is not going to change for quite a while, not just because of the politics, but the states are really sort of solidly entrenched in terms of where they are both, all the states are going in terms of its Medicaid programs. So let me provide some summary thoughts here, just in terms of the idea of access, because we're now, this is really access post-ACA. What we talk about, you know, we discuss the notion of access to health insurance. Doesn't necessarily mean that it is access to care, as we can see by the data. It certainly could be adequate or inadequate health insurance. That's adequate or inadequate, which means individuals could certainly have insurance, but it might not meet their needs. Individuals' needs also fluctuate as well, fluctuate as life, employment, family changes as well. And, you know, hopefully once in our lifetime, we're thrown a curveball like the pandemic, which throws everything out of whack. But really the primary solution to the uninsured issue is to elevate, which was really elevating the federal poverty guideline limits to 133. So 100% of the federal poverty limit to 133, 138. And that was really, you know, the crux of moving lots of individuals up. What hasn't materialized is really the supply issue, challenges to the supply. So when we have 33 million or 35 million Americans who now have access to insurance, will they use it all at once? The short answer is really no. Individual behaviors don't necessarily change. Certainly they have access mainly to preventive type services, not all the time. But the supply issues have not been challenged in the way that at least some have thought. Now, there's still a big supply issue, especially when it comes to acute care, but also other areas as well that have been tested since the passage of the ACA. Okay, so let me just finish my thought. So on certainly the Blackboard site, not only just some hopefully thoughtful readings, but also thinking about the bigger picture is a very macro way of looking at the impact of undoubtedly the most profound change to the U.S. healthcare system since the passage of Medicare and Medicaid. Okay, I'm going to stop right here, folks. Thanks very much. And as always, feel free to let me know if you have any questions. Take care.